Hello, Cynthia. It's so nice to have you join us. How are you feeling today?
I'm all right, Amy. How are you?
Very well, thank you. Yeah,
Thank
so
you
it's
for
really nice to
asking.
have you. I'm happy to have. Sorry?
Thank you for having me.
No problem at all. It's so happy to ha it's nice to have a familiar face, someone I know, someone I trust, someone I believe in. So it's really nice to have you here, and I hope the viewers are excited as well. So I mean, I'll just get right into it. I'll just say something to the viewers. If you have any question at any point for Cynthia as we're speaking, feel free to leave a comment in the comment box, and I'll pause the conversation, raise it up, and have her answer the question. So for now, Cynthia, I think we'll just get right into it. So of course, tell us more about yourself, who you are, your story, how you got into sport. Tell the viewers everything. Sorry, I can't hear you. Is your mic muted? I think it's muted. Let's unmute.
Is that
Perfect.
better?
That's better. I can hear you now.
Okay.
Go ahead, tell us about
Great,
yourself.
great. Right. So my name is Cynthia Mumbo. I run a sports consultancy in Nairobi, Sports Connect Africa. I'm very crazy passionate about sports, but also passionate about our continent and being able to create opportunities for young people through sport. And especially on a commercial perspective. I started playing when I was a kid, actually. I knew I wanted to be in sports since I was pretty young, maybe about six. And I was very lucky to have people around me who, were very sporty, the likes of Benjamin Ayimba, former rugby coach of the Kenya team, well accomplished. And when we were kids, I remember he used to make us run. And I would win, and he'd give me his medals. Him and the rest of the team, they'd give me their medals, and I was so excited because I learned how to win at that, particular moment. And I knew for as long as I could remember, I want to be like him. I want to be like Sally. I want to be like Philip. And wherever I went, I always found myself either running, sprinting, playing some basketball or whatever. So I started playing basketball in high school. I remember when I went to high school, I was about 14, 13, 14. And I was forced, in Kenyan high schools, I think the first thing they take you to is a hockey pitch. I remember going into the hockey pitch, and that first day, there were two injuries, and I promised myself they would never see me on that pitch again. So I did go eventually. I went to the basketball court, held the ball, threw it in first try. It was a basket. I don't know whether it was the proper way of doing it or not, but I remember the ball just went through the net, and that was it for me. So I played basketball all my life. I've been in the basketball industry with I sat in the executive committee of the Kenya Basketball Federation as a co-opted member for several years, about 7 years. I was interestingly the youngest member of KBF at that time. I joined the federation at 25, so that was pretty young, working with a a children, but also understand what our generation was looking for, and just the kind of conversations we were having around this is versus this is what older people think basketball should look like. Then after that, parallel to that, actually, I was working in the corporate world. So I had my first job at a former Firestone, which is Samira Africa. So I used to sell tires. I've been in sales and marketing for as long as I can remember. And I kind of found it interesting how corporates work. How come, sports doesn't work that way? And I always had these questions around why is it that we when we see European football, when we see basketball, international basketball, the NBA and stuff, why is it that there's always a commercial conversation that we're not getting right? And working in corporate really helped me kind of see, the two and two, and especially working in marketing, I got to understand that, hey, my product in this case is a tire, but what if, and this is the situation that goes on, the product on this other end is sport. Then how do we package sport? How do we, how do we sell the sport who fans and stuff like that. And that's when my, you know, my head kind of started running around, okay, if I'm not going to play at the topmost international level, how then am I going to use what it is I have as an athlete and this balance with what I'm getting to learn from the corporate, be able to merge those two to put something together. So I did work in corporate. I worked for Yana, which is Firestone. I worked for East African Breweries Limited in sales as well, and I worked for Menengai Oil Refineries and Chandaria for a short period of time. The last two were purely marketing jobs. I was head of marketing and for both organizations, and on the other end, the other two, I was working in sales. So, you know, really getting a direct connection with the consumer, understanding the consumer, and this kind of really pushed my desire to create some sort of change in sport, because I could get to see that sports is just the product, you know, it's a social product. It's a little different from every product that we sell. And that goes on, you know, with every other product. If you're selling Blue Band, it's not like selling tires. So it's really an understanding, you know, who are the fans or who are the consumers in sport and what do they need? And, you know, on this, how do we merge that with these consumers want and what it is that we're offering in sport? That drove me to start Sports Connect Africa. I registered the company in 2012, and I'm glad we're talking about development, because I have to be very honest with a lot of entrepreneurs out there. I chickened out to start with. It was pretty scary, and I went to corporate and how corporates run, and then coming to a point where okay, we need to put money to run this business. We need to, you know, we need to learn about people. It was a whole mess. And then I backtracked. I actually went back into employment. But, you know, the business kind of stood there. And in 2016, I went all out. I decided, okay, this is really genuinely what I want to do. It's my passion. It doesn't matter which direction I take. I'm always finding myself coming back to the sports, you know, the sports business conversation, the sports development conversation. So what we ended up doing, you know, I got my friends together, a couple of friends, and we started, you know, doing some events. We did basketball events. Mm-hmm. And then ultimately we decided to put together products. And one of our, you know, critical product that we have, because it's my background of love and, you know, passion for basketball, is what we call the Vikapu Elite Basketball Academy. So we upskill basketballers from the age of 6 all the way to 20. The amazing thing is, when we finished our first cohort last year, they asked me, Miss, when are we setting up a team? So now we have a basketball team of under 18s, which, you know, it's really cool. And hopefully, you know, it'll grow into something that will outlive both myself and, you know, all these young kids, and we'll be able to inspire other young kids to get into the game. We also have what we call the Africa Sports Business Mixer, which is a networking forum for, you know, sports stakeholders, you know, within and out. And the idea behind that is, you know, how do we bring together, you know, pretty much like what you're doing in this case, but you know, we really push a lot behind the commercial perspective. So sports marketing, you know, sports law, and you know, all these aspects of sports that we really don't understand. We bring in you know, experts and practicing sports stakeholders to have conversations with different sport. And then on the other end, we also do, you know, consultancy work, so sports events, sports marketing, and you know, basically coming up with solutions for sports stakeholders, whether you're a corporate, you want to run something that's sports oriented, or you want some advice, or if on this other end you're a sports entity and you're looking for partnerships and things like that.
I love how you know you specialize in all the different aspects and you're doing all of them brilliantly. On today's focus, I want to ask you more about actually the Vikapu Elite Basketball Academy, because you know our theme today obviously is development, and I just want to know what your vision is. I want you to speak more about this, the impact it's had, and you know what you've observed and how this actually plays a role towards sports development in your case at the grassroots.
Oh no, it's been a life-changing experience, not just for me but for myself and the team. We've learned so much around, you know, the impact that you can have just by being able to connect with young people. Mm-hmm. We started with four kids 3 years ago. We were to have our, you know, we should have been having our camp, April camp going on, and we had at least 100 kids, you know, requesting. Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, it's, I guess it is what it is, and fine, and all our kids are fine. Mm-hmm. But the amazing thing is we don't even do the selling. You know, these kids go out there and they talk to their fellow kids. The thing about our program is that we've packaged it in such a way that it's not about just basketball, and basketball's very important, but we keenly, and this is something that we share with the kids very keenly, that it's not just about basketball. You have your basketball, yes, but then life skills are so critical. And I'd love to invite you, you know, to come and have a session with the kids at some point, and especially on the life skills element, because what our curriculum pushes is for the kids to train each other. Mm-hmm. We do have our coach, Harry, who is a certified coach, and we have Coach Zeddy, who leads our basketball development program. Coach Zeddy is actually a counselor. He's studying psychology at Daystar University. So we're very keen on, you know, the life element. Last year, we had five kids who had their exams, their 844 exams, end year exams. And it was so fascinating because we had fights with parents. They were like, you know what? We love basketball, yes, but, you know, school is more important than basketball. Yeah. And we had a hard time convincing them, but we eventually did. And we were like, look, if these kids don't do well, come back to us, you know. And it's amazing. We had, out of the five, we had four A's and one B plus.
Fantastic. Yes.
And the conversation that we were getting back from parents was, this thing has been really good for my son or for my daughter, because it's not just about the impact that we're giving them on the pitch, and which is good because, you know, they stay fit. They say, you know, they're constantly putting in their time. But more so, it is what it has been able to do for their minds and their growth and the influence that they have on other kids. So in terms of, you know, just how they present themselves, how they carry themselves around each other, how they carry themselves around other kids, we call it the Vikapu way. And, you know, many times whenever we go out, a lot of other kids are always asking, hey, how can I come to your, you know, to your camp? How can I be part of, and not asking us, they're asking their fellow kids because how come off as either cool, I don't know, it's a cool thing, but that we, you know, what we've really pushed is to make having good manners a good and important thing for the kids. So we go beyond we go beyond the court.
And that's exactly what I was going to resonate with. I love what you said about self-development. It's something I believe in so much as well. And just to touch on that, I wanted to ask you more about personally, before we talk about the kids, you know, what's one skill that has actually supported you in your career in terms of self-development? What's one skill that's actually brought you where you are today and supports you in your growth?
Just discipline. It's easy to get swayed away. It's very easy. And to be very fair and to be very honest, being an entrepreneur, it's hard. Sometimes you don't make what it is that you think you're going to make. But, you know, having the discipline to say that, you know, this is the course I've taken. This is the direction I want. These are the outcomes that I'm looking at. And no matter what, I will fall. It's okay to fall, but I'll get back up and I'll keep moving. And that for me, over and over and over, is itself, even today. No matter how difficult the course is, You just have to keep going. Find the challenges, jump over them, crawl under them if you have to. Yeah. But you know what? Beat the challenges and be disciplined around that.
Fantastic. And how can the live audience implement that? So, you know, if someone's sitting at home right now watching this and going like, but I think I'm disciplined, you know, what are the small things they need to do to actually build that discipline and use it in their day-to-day lives?
Okay, so what I did a long time ago was I said, in 10 years, where do I want to be? And it doesn't have to be that way for everybody. So then I break it down and say, okay, I knew that in 10 years I was going to be running a company. I didn't know what, I knew it was a sports company. I just didn't figure out what it looked like. But yeah, I knew that I wanted to be in sports. So have your long-term vision and say, in the long term, this is what I want. This is where I want to be. This is what I want this to look like. And then break it downwards and say, okay, walk backwards and say, okay, so in 10 years, it's going to look like this. What do I need to do to get to that big place? But then also have daily goals that you look your, you know, and say weekly goals, monthly goals. In the next 1 month, this is what I want to be able to achieve. In the next 5 months, this is, or in the next half year, this is what I want to achieve. And walk slowly towards that. It, you know, it's the little steps that take us to the big, you know, to the top of the hill. So know what, be very, very critical about what those steps need to be. Mm-hmm. And work, achieving, get to the top of the hill. Of course, maybe unless you fly, but even then you need to walk into the plane. You need to start, you know, you need to even learn how to fly the plane and all of that. So there's always steps that you need to take to get to where you need to be. The other thing I'm going to say is have mentors, have people that push you out of your comfort zone. Like have people that call you and ask you, you said you were going to do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Have you? You know? Mm-hmm. And I have plenty of those around me. I'm very thankful. Be prayerful. I mean, you know, people have different beliefs and stuff, but I personally, I'm very thankful that God has given me an opportunity. So I'm, you know, constantly praying for guidance to kind of follow the direction that I need to be following and doing the things that I need to do. Be consistent. So there's one thing to be disciplined, there's another thing to be consistent. So if you're doing A and then you're doing C, and then you're doing Z, results that you want.
Fantastic. Now, on that point, I'm actually just going to pause with my own line of thought and just bring up, I've seen there's a question that's just come in. And so basically, one of the viewers is asking, what about capital? You know, you're talking about this whole business journey. It's up on the screen, as you can see, you know, but what's the perfect source for budding entrepreneurs in regards to capital? So,
sorry, I missed you there for a second. You're asking what about capital?
Exactly. So the question states, what about capital? What's a perfect source for budding entrepreneurs?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so very interesting. I spent a lot of what I would call, I was very lucky to have what we call goodwill to support what I was doing. But also, there's it's very important, and especially in our line of work, you've done right. So the venting, we started with small stuff, you know. I started working from home. I didn't necessarily have an office. Get to know what capital means for you. I'm also going to be very, very honest that I had a very, very strong backing from my mom and my dad, who are still directors in the company, by the way. They're very, and I know, Amy, you understand what this means. I know your parents have been very supportive of it and the direction that you're taking. So my parents have been very supportive. I did work for several years, so I did have some savings. And I invested part of what it is that I had in especially building networks. So our business is a business of relationships. The business of sports is a business of relationships. Spend what you can on building networks. And finding that capital is very, very, you know, critical you have your seed capital, you know the people around you, and once you've built up, then you can start looking for funding in various avenues. But I've always believed that your sweat capital cannot be outbid. You have to put in the work first, and you know, be able to patch this whole idea of yours together, and then get other people to believe in it, to invest behind what it is that you're doing.
Yes, Cynthia, I love what you've said about building relationships, actually. And I just want to ask you a bit to highlight and, you know, speak to the viewers a bit more about that, you know, about the importance of actually, because a lot of people don't realize a lot of it is support from other people just as much as the hard work you do yourself. So can you please, you know, share a bit more about, you know, how you can build sustainable partnerships or, you know, conversations and relationships with people who can help you aside from just doing your work and doing it alone?
Right. So the first thing is you need to know your stuff. So you can't walk into conversations with people if you don't know what you're talking about, or if you don't know where it is that you're going or where it is that you want to be. So be very critical about knowing what you're about and what it is that, you know, your purpose is and what it is that you want to achieve. The next thing is, you know, find the networks, or find the spaces where the people that you want to meet would be. LinkedIn has worked extremely well for me. I've been on LinkedIn since 2008, and it's been a very, young as I look, I know I look, you think I'm young like you, but LinkedIn, but also being at the right place at the right time, and you need to know what that means. I've spent quite a bit of money being at the right place at the right time to just speak sometimes to one person. I've taken a flight to South Africa to be in the right room with one person who, you know, I said, this is my goal. I want to be able to meet this person. I want to be able to know them. I want to be able to connect with them. And in the right moment, went there and I said, hi, my name is Cynthia Mumbo. This is what I do. This is my passion. This is where I want to be. I'd like to learn from you. I'd like to, you know, work with you or partner with you in some way. And keep your word. So if you're you know, going to have a conversation with somebody, say you're going to do something, do it. Our business is the business of relationships. And it's so clear even now in this particular environment that we're facing. It's all about staying in touch with people. It's a very contact, I would say business. People don't understand, when people watch the guys on the pitch or on a basketball court or playing karate or whatever, that there's a whole, you know, relationship business that's going on behind the scenes between marketers, between lawyers, between all these different, you know, people who are coming together. And I think it's really important that you know what you're about, but also don't waste people time, and know who you want to connect with. And as they say, shoot your shot, get there. Yeah. The worst I can tell you is no. The worst someone can tell you is no, but then you move on. You don't stick there and say, oh, this person didn't want to connect with me. No, you accept what it is and you move on to the next one. Keep a database. Keep a database, know who is who. Know when to reach out to the right kind of people when you need to, and don't be afraid. The worst, again, that can happen is someone will tell you no, and their no should be respected, because, you know, you never know why they did say that or not, but you keep going.
Fantastic, Cynthia. That was brilliant. Now, as you wrap up, I just want to know one more thing related to, you know, the day to day. It's the International Day of Sports for Development and Peace. So I just wanted to touch on it a little bit and to let us know, you know, generally in the, you know, on a global scale, how important do you think sports development and peace is for our society?
Well, I think it's critical. Looking at where we are now, I think sports is going to play a really big role. It's so difficult to say where we will be in the next week. No, we can't say is that sport is really critical in bringing us together, and you know, we can't run away from that. So we as sports people, you know, how will we use the platforms that we have? How will we use the opportunities that we have to bring there's always a critical role in, if you want to provide health in a community, which is the easiest way to bring people together. Put, you know, a sports event, and you'll find the kids will come and probably the parents will come. If you want to distribute something, then, you know, you put together a sports event and people come together. Sports has a way of bringing people together. Nelson Mandela showed us, you know, the way. He said sports, you know, sports changes the world, and it truly, truly does. So we are, I think personally, I'm very lucky to be working in this kind of environment, and very blessed to be working in this kind of environment. And my purpose and my hope is to be able to use the skills that I have and the platforms that I have to be able to make a change, not just for the people around me, but for the continent as well.
Fantastic. Now, Cynthia, for the live audience, if they would like to interact with you, talk more with you about, you know, everything you've shared today and everything that you do, can you please let them know how they can interact with you, you know, social media, email, what, how should they reach out to you?
Pretty easy. So I'm on LinkedIn, Cynthia Mumbo, Twitter, search Cynthia Mumbo, Facebook, Cynthia Mumbo. It's pretty easy. Those are my three key platforms. I am Cymumbo, although I don't use that so much for the sporting platforms, but LinkedIn and Twitter are my key platforms for what I do with sport, and you'll find me there, just Cynthia Mumbo.
Fantastic. Now, to everyone watching, please share your biggest takeaway from Cynthia. You can comment here on Facebook. Let us know what has been the biggest takeaway. We're also trying to, you know, trend on Twitter. So please head over there, share something, and don't forget to use the hashtag Spirit of Sport. Right. Thank you so much, Cynthia. It's been fantastic having you on. I look forward to speaking with you, expanding this conversation, and seeing everything wonderful that you're going to do.